This week on Wealth Track, the investment wisdom of two experienced financial planners. Vern Hayden and Mark Cortazzo will help you pick the best mutual funds and guide your planning for retirement. Next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
Stocks rose sharply yesterday, driven by reports of good earnings.
Opportunity favors the prepared mind. BlackRock.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. This week we're focusing on retirement and long-term mutual fund investing. Starting this year, the vanguard of the 83 million baby boomers, those born from 1946 to 1964, will be eligible for Social Security. Some will be retiring. Many are thinking about it. Financial services firms have responded with a huge array of low-fee or free retirement services, all designed to attract lucrative boomer assets. But what if you want more customized planning? That's where the services of a financial planner can come in. Now be aware that anyone can put out a shingle and call themselves a financial planner. But there are two professional organizations which work hard to bring a level of professionalism and education to the industry. One is the Financial Planning Association, whose members range from fee-based planners to accountants, to life insurance agents, to stockbrokers. Many FPA members are certified financial planners who have taken courses and passed a stiff two-day board certification test. Then there is the much smaller National Association of Personal Financial Advisors, a professional group of fee-only planners, meaning they don't collect any commissions from the products they recommend. This week, we're going to meet two highly regarded certified financial planners. Our first guest, Mark Cortazzo, was named one of the 250 best financial advisors in America by Worth Magazine. He's earned numerous awards and been profiled in many industry publications. The Wall Street Journal's Jonathan Clements, Kiplinger's Mary Beth Franklin, and other journalists count on Mark as a resource for their personal finance columns. In a recent interview, I asked Mark to take me through the process. How does he begin preparing clients for retirement?
We look at this process like we're building a house, and before you do anything, you really need a blueprint. So we do what's called a factor analysis. We will look at every single position that you have, every mutual fund that you have, every stock that you have, if you own annuities, and we put them into a program, and it will analyze what you have in large cap stocks and small cap stocks and international, and not just looking at the label of the investment, but actually looking at the ingredients, because many times you'll see a fund that's called something, but it may have small caps or international in there, even though that's not in its name. So I want to see what you truly have.
Now, what I truly have, is that just financial assets, or do you also look at my real estate, my home?
Total net worth.
Jewelry, collectibles, art.
Ownership in a business, any of those things. And what we do is we look at, what are things that you have a lot of flexibility control over, and what are things that you don't have a lot of flexibility control over. Then we'll do a cash flow analysis, and we'll look at what are your expenses. You know, what are you spending on a daily basis for, property taxes and food and energy and
travel.
Everything.
Okay.
We look at what percentage of your need is truly need, and what is discretionary, because that's very important in how we design a solution for someone, because there's the needs in your life and there's the wants in your life, and we have to make sure that your needs are addressed. And sometimes people, in pursuit of their wants, take more risk, and if that doesn't work out, not only do they not achieve their wants, but they might not be able to sustain their needs because of this risk that they assumed. So we do these cash flow analysis, and inevitably, year one, there's this spike up, and people go, I'm so far out of budget. I have all of the spending. If I keep spending at this rate, I'm not going to be able to sustain my retirement.
And you agree with them, right?
Yes, but most of the time these are one-offs. They're the one cruise that they've wanted to take, but couldn't. They didn't have 2 weeks that the couple could take off at the same time. Or fixing up the house, or these are one-time events. So we budget for that, because it happens like clockwork. So we get a snapshot of where you are. And then we need to know what your needs are and what your goals are, because if we're going through this house building analogy, if we build you this beautiful home and you have five daughters and there's only one bathroom in the house, we might have a problem in the morning. And although it's a beautiful home, it doesn't meet your needs. So
let me ask you, because you've told me that the two of the biggest mistakes that people make have to do with their mortality, and the other one is having to do with the withdrawal rates.
Correct.
So talk to me about what's the mistake that people make about the mortality.
Most times, it's underestimating how long they're going to live. Their parents died at a particular age, and they have that in their mind. And advances in medicine and people's awareness of how well they're eating, et cetera, is really pushed mortality out. And at 65 years, a 65-year-old couple, you have a 25% chance of one of them living to 97. That's
right.
They could be retired longer than they worked, and people aren't planning for that long of a cash flow coming from their portfolios.
So let's talk about that, because the other thing that you stressed is a mistake is really not understanding the withdrawal process. We all understand the accumulation phase, but we've never experienced the distribution phase. So what's the difference?
I'll give you a good example. If you retired on January 1st of 2000,
right,
and you invested in the S&P 500, and you looked
God
at
God help you.
You looked at the long-term historical average, and it had averaged 10% a year. And in January of 2000, people were still feeling pretty good. The Y2K didn't blow up the world, and we thought we were going to have strong equity markets. So you looked at long-term averages being 10% a year. You took what you thought was a conservative withdrawal rate and said, I'm going to take 6% a year from my portfolio. And in July of this year, the S&P hit a new all-time high. And so we had the market go down. It came back up, hit a new all-time
high.
This
is in 2000.
I'm saying in 2000, you started taking your withdrawals. But in 2007,
right,
the S&P has hit a new all-time high.
Right.
And with your conservative withdrawal rate of 6% and the market hitting a new all-time high, you have 50 cents on the dollar left of your original investment.
Because of what the market did, number one, in those first couple of years, and also you taking out more money as the market went down.
Correct. A larger percentage of your portfolio.
Right.
You were taking a constant dollar out, but now that 6% becomes a much larger percent of what's left in the portfolio.
So what should we have done? We had to retire, with $1 million in the S&P 500. In 2000.
Diversification has always been a staple in managing the risk of your portfolio.
Right. So diversity really counts. It really makes a big difference.
It really is a driver. And the problem right now that retirees are having is they're not familiar and comfortable with small cap stocks. They're not as familiar and comfortable with international stocks, mm-hmm, or emerging markets. There's countries that they've never that they couldn't find on a map.
Right.
And we're asking them to invest money in there. So those type of investments might work better in some type of protected environment or something that has a safety net, because people should have exposure there. They just might not be comfortable to jump in head first.
So let me ask you about withdrawal rates, because one of the there's a kind of a consensus that you should be withdrawing no more than 4 to 4.5% of your portfolio every year.
Yeah, and that's the academics can prove that to you several different ways. The problem is, have a retiree come to you who's saved for decades, who has $1 million in their 401k that they roll over, and now they're taking this 4% withdrawal rate. The $40,000 is coming out. They're paying 30% tax between state and federal, and they have $28,000 after tax to live on. And if you live in New Jersey in a moderate house in my town, you're paying $16,000 a year in taxes. It's more than half of your income. So it
doesn't work for
It doesn't work, and many people are coming to us saying, I'm young, I'm healthy, I'm able to do a lot more things, and I would rather more income now and have less income later on. And managing that risk of a healthier initial withdrawal rate, maybe not even indexed for inflation, maybe starting with a higher rate of 6% and then paring back some of your expenses if a meaningful percentage of your expenses are discretionary.
Mm-hmm.
If you're living, if these expenses, you need to draw 6%, and that's need, that's covering your food and keeping the lights on and property tax, you don't have a lot of flexibility and a lot of ability to cut back. So in those situations, maybe looking at an immediate annuity or something where you have a core part of your fixed expenses covered.
So let me ask you about the first individual that has the $1 million, but he can't afford, and the family cannot afford just to take, you know, $40,000 a year. So what's their alternative?
Well, they can look at spending down principal. Mm-hmm.
And when do you advise? I mean, you know, when, if ever, do you advise that?
Looking at the client's goals, we ask clients, if the market doesn't do well, do you want to sacrifice quality of life, or do you want to leave less to your beneficiaries? Because
right.
we have two different camps in our client mm-hmm. base. Some of them would eat macaroni and cheese three nights a week to make sure that their children get that $1 million, and we have others that say, we help them with school, we help them with their first home, you know, and now we need to take care of ourselves.
Right.
And if I spent my last dollar on my last day and maintain my quality of life and my standard of living, that would be okay.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an objective, but it would be an okay outcome. And we can manage around that, because then we can look to either annuitize some money or eat into principal.
Let me ask you about, too, the different mindset that you need to bring to the table when you're in a distribution phase and in retirement. The tax consequences, it's almost the opposite, right, of what you need to think about. So tell me what accounts we should be withdrawing from.
Absolutely.
First, and what should still stay in a tax-deferred account? How does that work?
Well, one of the interesting things we see is people have been throwing money into retirement accounts, IRAs, 401ks, for accumulation for retirement. And they may have, as an example, $500,000 in CDs and money markets in outside of their IRA, because they wanted to have access to that while they
right,
were
that's your liquid
right. money, and you weren't 59 and a half yet, so you couldn't touch this IRA, so that was your safe money. And you had your long-term growth investment money in the IRA, so you have your stock mutual funds
right.
in there, and maybe there's $500,000 in that IRA. If when you retired, you bought that same index fund of stocks outside the IRA, and bought those same CDs inside your IRA, when you take the interest from the CDs from your IRA, it's taxable as ordinary income, just as it was outside of your IRA. But now the stocks that you have, if they appreciate in value, when you go to sell them, you're only paying a capital gains rate.
Mm-hmm.
If that stock portfolio does well and your $500,000 grows to $800,000 between now and when you pass away, your beneficiaries get a step up in basis. They can sell that $800,000 worth of stock and pay no taxes. If that accumulation occurred in your IRA, that $300,000 worth of gain and all of your original basis is all taxable at the higher brackets of ordinary income. So just making that one change without changing your allocation, but changing
right.
your process, can extend the longevity of that distribution from your retirement plan assets for several years, because you have more net spendable income
mm-hmm.
by managing where you own what you own.
Okay. Final question. Should you become more aggressive as when you retire with your investments or more conservative? A lot of people say that you should become more conservative.
You really need to manage around the income need. If you have, you know, a steady, predictable income like a pension and Social Security that can cover your fixed needs,
mm-hmm.
then you can be more aggressive, because, like I said earlier, you could be retired for 20, 25, 30, 35 years. So long-term, if you have a long-term objective for some of this money, it still should be invested in things that are equity-oriented. If you're not comfortable doing that, then you need to figure out a way to either hedge that risk or transfer that risk. Or if you have enough money, maybe you don't need to take any additional risk. You have a big enough pool of money, even a modest interest rate could be enough to sustain a healthy lifestyle. Why take more risk than you need to?
Mark Cortazzo, thank you so much for joining us. This has been very enlightening. We really appreciate your being here.
It was a pleasure.
Thanks. Well, our second guest is another certified financial planner who has been in private practice for some 35 years. Vern Hayden specializes in portfolio management using mutual funds run by managers that Hayden thinks are the cream of the crop. The Hayden Financial Group specializes in serving the needs of high net worth individuals, but he is sharing his wisdom and some specific recommendations with us. In a recent interview, I asked Vern why he manages his clients' assets using mutual funds rather than other approaches, including investing in individual stocks.
Well, I liked the mutual funds because I really can pick a manager. And I look at it almost like picking the members of a team. You know, like I'm the coach. My client is always the owner of the team. And I pick the players. And the players can be both offense, defense, occasionally special teams, which might be a sector or two, but not much of that. Mm-hmm. And so I want to know who the best offense managers are where they're going to make money in up markets. And the best defensive managers who will stop us from losing money in a down market. And consequently, once a portfolio is put together, generally what happens is we will capture around 80% of an up market and somewhere between 30 and 50% of a down market. And if you were to work that out over a period of time, it comes out pretty good.
So how do you pick a money manager? I mean, how do you decide which offense money manager is the best and which defense money manager is the best?
Well, I might even, if I hear of a fund and I don't know the mm-hmm. manager, I will look at the fund and the first thing I'll look at are the down periods. And then I'll look at how long the manager has been. I want that manager to have gone through those down periods mm-hmm. like 2000, 2002. And if they've done really well, then I want to get acquainted with the managers.
So let me ask you, I mean, how many funds would you have in a typical portfolio if there is such a thing?
Well, if we took a nice round figure of $500,000, mm-hmm. I would probably have about eight funds. Eight funds, somewhere in there. Say and, seven to ten funds, possibly.
Right. And yeah. and what percentage are you know the more aggressive funds, and which percentage are the more defensive funds?
Again, it's going to depend on the client.
Right.
I don't have any models that I put people in. Every portfolio is individually designed. There's a lot of commonality, depending on again somebody's risk tolerance.
Right.
But I really got to understand the risk that somebody can take, and then I try to match that with the amount of risk in the portfolio. So if I want to dampen risk, I will use more hybrid funds, those funds that can allocate between the different asset classes, as well as some bond funds or funds like a Hussman fund that can go short, who does just stellar during bad times.
Mm-hmm. So are there any core funds that you have in all of your portfolios?
Yes.
I mean, if, can you give me just a couple of names?
Capital
of...
Income Builder is mm-hmm. one with the American Funds Group. Vanguard, Wellesley, or Wellington, depending again on how much risk somebody wants to take. But they're both pretty conservative funds. And the Thornburg Investment Income Builder Fund, which is an asset allocation type fund also. And those are the main ones.
Right.
That,
so, and how often, I mean, do you, you know, you have told me that you don't time markets, you time your clients.
Right.
Tell me what you mean by that, and also, do you time your mutual fund managers, the money funds that you own, the mutual funds that you own?
Well, sometimes, especially if they're a new client, we try to gauge how much risk they can handle.
And how do you gauge that with them? I mean,
well,
how do you tell?
I do have a little test kind of thing that
right.
I found.
A questionnaire
in,
or something.
It's
that they
a questionnaire,
take?
But I found it in Australia, and it's better than most of the others that I've seen.
All right.
And. It's just a fun process to go through that with a client because it poses some interesting, very Rorschach almost type questions. And so we discuss those. And then sometimes I use, I have money in an envelope. I might have $1,000 in an envelope and I'll give it to them and take $500 out and see how they feel about that. Because you have to tangibilize, is that a word?
Sounds right to me.
You have to make tangible
right.
Kind of an abstract sort of subject. And so I try to do it that way.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes people still don't get it until they go through a period that we've just are going through.
Right.
Or back in 2000.
Or a market downturn.
That's right.
They don't really understand risk until they go through some tough times.
Absolutely. They have to feel it sometimes to really know it. And so that's when we get a call from a relatively new client where we've not gone through that
right.
with them, and then we'll talk with them and then we'll tweak it. I'm not the kind of an advisor or manager that will say, look, this is going to be okay, just fine over the long term. I'm not a fixed asset allocator like some are, where it's proven academically over a long period of time that it'll work out just fine. Well, the only thing it leaves out are the emotions and the ability to sleep on the part of a client. It leaves out the humanistic component. And that's an extremely important component to have.
Do you time the mutual funds that you own, for instance? I mean, you know, there have been times when value has outperformed growth or growth has outperformed value. I mean, do you find yourself doing that, or do you basically stick with the managers and let them make those decisions?
I will do some tweaking if I feel that it's a definite trend that's going to last for maybe a year or two.
Mm-hmm.
I may do some tweaking, not major, but I may take 10 or 15% out of a value fund and put it into a fund with more of a growth tilt, but not an extreme growth philosophy, because I like the value over time much better. But typically I'll do that because clients like to have that kind of activity.
Right.
And I like to, you know, help please that part of the humanistic element too.
And so, and value funds, for instance, I mean, whose value funds do you think are going to do well over the next year?
Well, one that I really like a lot is David Winter's in Wintergreen.
Mm-hmm. He's been a guest on WealthTrack several times.
And it's a relatively new fund, mm-hmm. but he is an aged manager, being mentored under Michael Price, and he managed several of the mutual shares funds. And then with this fund, he's doing absolutely great.
Mm-hmm.
I like his philosophy. He's very bright,
mm-hmm.
and so I feel very confident about using his fund. And that's one of the value managers. Another one has to do with people you've had on from Fairholme.
Right, Bruce Berkowitz or Keith Trauner,
yeah,
right.
I think that's a fabulous fund, and I use it. I also use a fund which is located here in the city called Delafield,
mm-hmm.
managed by Dennis Delafield and Vincent Selecchia, because they've got an excellent track record, and they will go anywhere to find a good stock, and they like to buy it at the right price. So all three of those that I've just
right.
mentioned have a value tilt and come through bad markets in pretty good shape.
And, you know, Vern, the markets have gotten much more volatile. I mean, we've come through a period where of many years where we had very low market volatility. We're now in a period of much higher market volatility. What do you do different in a market environment like this?
We try to constantly test our portfolios and try not to make the portfolios volatile. We try to smooth out the ride by having well-diversified and allocated portfolios. And every time there is a volatile period like we're going through, we test our portfolios. Even if clients
mm-hmm.
aren't calling us, we're looking at the portfolios very closely. And so we want to see how volatile they are. If the market goes down, we'll even do that on a daily basis. We don't tell our clients to do that,
mm-hmm.
but if the market went down 2% yesterday, the S&P 500 or whatever, we want to see what happened to our portfolio. And we like to see either stay even or maybe even go up a little bit if our defensive funds are performing the way we like. So we try to even out that volatility. Level it out.
So one last question. To even out the volatility, you go to the more defensive funds.
That's right. Yep. And we're constantly working with the percentages. You know, do we have like 40 or 50% in the hybrid funds, which help level out a portfolio during volatile times? And it does have that effect.
All right.
And then funds like Wintergreen and so forth, I mean, they're not getting killed in a volatile market. They're
mm-hmm.
holding the fort really well.
Terrific. Vern Hayden, thank you so much for joining us on WealthTrack.
Thank you, Consuelo. It's a pleasure to be here.
At the conclusion of every WealthTrack, we give you one suggestion to help you get through any volatility in one piece so you can build or preserve your wealth. This week's action point, identify one source of guaranteed income for life. As Mark Cortazzo points out, if you have one guaranteed income stream to take care of some of life's essential bills, it will give you more flexibility to invest the rest of your retirement funds more aggressively to take advantage of the higher long-term returns found in more volatile investments like small cap and emerging market stocks. One kind of guaranteed income product is called an immediate annuity, where you invest a lump sum of money sometime after retirement and start to receive payouts immediately. These payments then continue for the rest of your life, no matter how long you live. Another guaranteed income product that's relatively new is called longevity insurance. It's not really insurance, but another income vehicle that is designed to kick in for those lucky enough to live until 85 years and older. A handful of firms offer it now, more will in the future. There are other annuities which have been around for much longer. They usually involve a lump sum given to an insurance company to invest tax-deferred. Then at a chosen date in the future, they start to pay you a monthly income. A fixed annuity pays you a predetermined fixed amount, which, if not adjusted for inflation, can be ravaged by it. A variable annuity pays you an amount that depends on the underlying investments. We will have links on all of these guaranteed income products on our website, www.wealthtrack.com. Now, that said, all of these investments are complicated and they require a discussion with one or more professionals. But even a small stream of guaranteed income for life can help you sleep better at night. And that concludes this edition of Wealth Track. Thank you for visiting with us. If you missed any part of this program or want to see it again, just go to our website, WealthTrack.com. It will be available for web and podcast viewing starting Monday. Until next time, make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
Opportunity favors the prepared mind. BlackRock.